Thank you. The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 9747 in the name of Alec Rowley on supporting the work of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Alec Rowley to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to begin by thanking all members who have signed my motion for the debate today and to all members participating in the debate here this evening. Established in 1999, the Coalfields Regeneration Trust was set up to support former industrial areas through community wealth building with a focus on economic development and regeneration of former coalfield areas. Now, anyone here who represents a former coalfield area will know the wealth of activity that has been supported by the Trust over the years. Indeed, the work has been recognised in this Parliament over many years, with a members' debate on the role of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust in Scotland held in the Chamber in 2007, led by then MSP Cathy Jamieson. In 2011, the late Helen Eady, MSP, secured a debate in this chamber celebrating the Coalfields Regeneration Trust and the work that they do in the former mining communities. Once more, in 2015, Christine Graham, MSP, led a members' debate on the continuing success of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. So I'm pleased to say that this Parliament over many years has given recognition to the work of the Coalfields Trust. Indeed, over the period of this Parliament since its inception in 1999, there have been 112 motions lodged by members acknowledging and celebrating the work of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust in Scotland. As such, I think it's fair to say that throughout its existence, the work of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust in Scotland has been recognised, respected and valued by all the political parties who operate within the Scottish Parliament. It's important to acknowledge at the outset of this debate that we are living with very difficult financial pressures on public finances. And this often means local community services struggle to meet local demand and local need. In acknowledging the difficult financial climate, I want to emphasise the point that it is now more crucial than ever to prioritise funding where it will have the greatest impact, and that is why I am calling tonight on the Government to look again at the £100,000 cut that has been made to the Coalfields Regeneration Trust budget. For the fact remains that the former coalfield communities still have some of the highest levels of poverty and inequality in Scotland. My experience representing such communities over many years is that for a small amount of resource and finance, the payback can be significant. You only need to scroll through the 112 motions that have been laid in this Parliament about the Coalfields Regeneration Trust to see the kind of impact a relatively small amount of money can have and has had. There are a host of regeneration projects that have made a big impact on local communities and indeed on local people. In Fife, the Crosshall Business Centre is now a place to locate and develop enterprise, as well as a venue for community-based learning and work. It has also supported hundreds of people over the years into further and higher education, as well as into employment. The zone in Dunmellington, East Ayrshire, is another great example of regeneration, as is Tweaker Health, the Leven Centre, and the Glenboig Development Trust, all doing amazing work, all with the support of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. The Trust has also had massive success in supporting local communities to build capacity in sport, in the arts, and building projects to help tackle isolation, in turn supporting communities to support themselves. A proud record indeed for, again, relatively small amounts of funding. And looking to the future, the Coalfields Regeneration Trust here in Scotland are asking the Scottish Government to provide a capital endowment of £20 million over a negotiated period of years to enable the CRT to build industrial starter units for SMEs, which would create a substantial, sustainable, long-term revenue stream to allow the CRT to be self-funding so that it can support former coalfield communities into the future. The CRT has already successfully rolled out this model in England, building industrial units which allow them to generate jobs and economic development and growth in deprived former coalfield communities, delivering real generation. The rental income then allows the CRT to fund its charitable activity through a secure and sustainable income stream. I take the view, Presiding Officer, that the best route out of poverty is through education, skills and employment. For many who've experienced generational poverty in some of our most deprived areas, they require more focused interventions with a great deal of support and encouragement. It is this kind of approach I have witnessed over many years coming from the Coalfields Regeneration Trust, building that capacity at the community level. I'm asking the Scottish Government to restate its commitment to this work by examining the following requests: to reverse the 100,000 cut to the funding, to change the Scottish Government procurement rules to allow the CRT to reinstate its grant programme, which is vital to many small local organisations and charities in coalfield communities, as has been demonstrated over so many years, and to examine the case for a capital endowment fund that would enable CRT to work with local communities to drive the skills and jobs agenda at a local level. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, while it is true we are going through difficult times financially, this is all the more reason to support this tried and tested organisation, an organisation that has the ability to provide direct support at the local level to empower our local communities. We celebrate their work. Let us ensure they have the funds to continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rowley. I now call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Mr MacGregor.
Presiding Officer, I want to thank Alex Rowley for bringing this members' debate to the Chamber. I and so many of my colleagues here represent constituencies and regions where coal mining was the main employer and economic driver of communities for generations, something that I am very proud of. By the end of the 19th century, Lanarkshire's 200 mines were producing around half of Scotland's coal, and farming villages and hamlets such as Coatbridge, where I represent, and Motherwell, where my colleague Claire Addison represents, had transformed into the large industrial towns we recognise today with their own communities and identities. As we all know, however, the 20th century was not kind to the mining industry. The second half of the 20th century saw nearly 1,000 mines being closed, transforming many of these former industrial juggernauts into communities which suffered from a lack of employment opportunities, health inequalities and poor educational attainment. These economic conditions devastated communities, and it was in this environment that the Coalfields Regeneration Trust was established in 1999. Set up as a charity, its mission was to create opportunities and support those who had felt the full effect of mining closures across the UK. The need for a trust such as the CRT is clear when you consider the statistics. In Scotland alone, 43% of the working age population of the Scottish coalfields is claiming some form of benefits, against a Scottish average of 23%. 40% of people in the Scottish coalfields have no qualifications, against 27% for Scotland as a whole, and the mortality rate in Scottish coalfields is 25% higher than the Scottish average. In the near 25 years since their establishment, CRT have been invaluable in improving health, skills and employment for the near 6 million people who currently live in these coalfield areas across the UK. My Coatbridge and Crycin constituency has many ex-mining villages, including Cardown and Moodysburn, where of course the community is still impacted by the tragic events of September 1959, when 47 men lost their lives in the Auchengeek mining disaster, an event I attend every year and have the pleasure of speaking at. And this year, received the honour of being presented with a miner's lamp from the Memorial Committee. And I put on record Richard Leonard's consistent and constant support for this event also. And I know that both Auchin Lock and Moody's Burn in the area near to Auchin Geek have been supported by the CRT, and I want to say that I'm very grateful for that and to those in the Chamber. But for the remainder of this speech, I will concentrate on the village of Glenboig, another industrial powerhouse in the 19th and 20th centuries, which also harshly felt the effects of the industry constricting over the last several decades. I have regular discussions with Theresa Aitken, who is the operations manager of the wonderful Glenboig Development Trust, as Alex Rowley mentioned, which provides the local residents of Glenboig and surrounding villages and communities with a wide range of high quality health improvement and community-based services and activities 7 days a week. Indeed, to demonstrate the work of Theresa and the Development Trust further, Theresa has recently been made a fellow at Cambridge University following her work with the Faculty of Social Innovation there to promote the work ethic of Glenboig Development Trust and share its practices and successes to help UK and international communities recover and flourish, end quote. High praise indeed, and I'm very proud of Theresa and all the team at Glenboig. And Theresa, when I spoke to her, was keen to stress how helpful and vital the Coalfields Regeneration Trust have been in ensuring the great work of the Glenboig Development Trust can continue in the community. Just some of the things that Glenboig have received funding for via the Regeneration Trust include community gardening and environmental projects, a parent and toddler group, older people's art groups, men's groups, stress relief initiatives and food growing projects. And this is also in addition to funding that Trust has provided to Glenboig United Football Club, Glenboig Parent Council and support for the Village Park play area. Indeed, although now a successful operation in its own right, I think it's fair to say that this success of the Glenboig Development Trust would not have been realised without the input of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust in those early years, which really seen it through. These projects and initiatives are the beating heart of our post-industrial communities, and in truth, I was disappointed to hear the Scottish Government had reduced the grant to the Coalfields Regeneration Trust by £100,000. What might seem like a meagre decrease in funding in comparison to other budgetary commitments will have huge consequences for places like Glenboig, which require funding from the CRT to enrich in my constituency and the surrounding area. And restrictions concerning Scottish Government procurement rules, as Alex Rowley mentioned, as well means that the CRT is also limited in running their grants programme to support smaller grassroots charities in these former coalfield communities. And these limitations have resulted in 13% of charities reporting their organisation is at risk of closure from the ending of the CRT grants programme. These communities have been let down by successive UK governments in the past, and I urge the Scottish Government to revisit these funding cuts and procurement rules, as we cannot let these communities down again. I do understand, we've had the statement today, the budgeting constraints imposed on us by this ruthless Tory Westminster government, but I do not feel that these already marginalised and penalised communities are the ones that should suffer again and more. As Theresa Aitken told me powerfully just yesterday when I spoke to her...
Mr McGregor, you'll need to bring your mic to a close well over your time.
OK, thank you. She just told me just yesterday, I'll finish on her words then, Presiding Officer. If funding is taken from these communities, then many of the social impacts that have been somewhat mitigated will return. Poverty, isolation and antisocial behaviour, to name but a few. And of course, this will lead to a greater burden on public services in the long run. I'll close there, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. I would remind members that it's backbench speeches of up to 4 minutes. I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to speak in this debate, and I thank my fellow Mid-Scotland and Fife MSP, Alex Rowley, for bringing this to the Chamber this evening. Today's debate provides a welcome opportunity to acknowledge the important work done by the Coalfield Regeneration Trust across the United Kingdom. It is also an opportunity to acknowledge the distinct characters that form Coalfield communities, several of which are located within central and southern Fife and across Clackmannanshire in my own region. Today's motion speaks about the all-party parliamentary group on Coalfield communities and the report of levelling up of former coalfields. This report speaks about the loss of coal mining jobs still casting a long shadow in these communities, Presiding Officer. It highlights that the total population of 5.7 million across the United Kingdom, these communities are too big to be ignored. The report also highlights the problems of social isolation, loneliness in these communities, which often affect a large population of older people. However, there are still issues with younger people who are finding it very difficult with the opportunities, work and training within these areas. Therefore, it's clear that these communities have particular needs and they require particular types of support. The funding mission of the Coalfield Regeneration Trust is therefore to provide these communities with the support it needs. These include initiatives such as Coalfield Work Project, and I acknowledge and commend the work they do. This project provides important support to people who have become separated from the labour market, and it provides work and mentoring. The project also helps a number of candidates secure permanent full-time work, and that's happened within Fife Council and within Stirling University. The success of Coalfield Works means that it brings the real opportunities that these communities need from across Scotland, and that is to be very much welcomed. And as I say, these young people have an opportunity to move forward. The project supports the Trust's funding, includes Grow West Fife, which supports low-income families across West Fife by providing them with homegrown produce. Funding from the Coalfield Regeneration Trust will also go to invest in the future for these families and continue to see that grow. Now, Alex Rowley and others already have mentioned tonight in this the cut of £100,000 from the budget for the Coalfield Regeneration, and that is a 13% cut, Presiding Officer. And it was right that previously, when cuts were talked about, that these cuts were reversed back in 2011. Over a decade later, it's worth what the Trust is doing so much more important work, and it cannot lose that funding because that will have a massive impact, as you've already heard from other speakers this evening. The Scottish Government has said it would like to see the Trust move to a more current funding model and explore new ways of funding the grant programme. That is important, but we need to make sure that the money goes where it should be, and that's what the Coalfield Regeneration Trust want to see. And I hope that the Minister will reflect and provide assurances to the Trust in his summing up later on this evening. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scotland's former coalfield communities have a distinct character, but they also have distinctive needs. The work of these initiatives across the United Kingdom and levelling up funds have a real role to play in addressing the needs that local government have to play also within these communities. However, the organisations such as the Coalfield Regeneration Trust are here and they're at the heart of supporting these communities. I thank them for the important work they do and they continue to carry out in the region that I represent and across Scotland as a whole. And I hope that we'll be able to continue to support them and communities for many, many years to come, because that's what's required. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. And I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Richard Leonard. Mr. Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a pleasure to contribute to this debate. And my thanks to Alex Rowley for again securing the opportunity tonight to talk about the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. And indeed, it's a pleasure to follow Alexander Stewart, who I think rightly encompassed this when he talked about our coalfield communities being too big to be ignored. They're not just too big, they sit at the heart of a network, a jigsaw that exists across the whole of Scotland, indeed across the whole of the United Kingdom. And the importance of our coalfields community, even those who are now removed from ancestors, parents, grandparents who worked in the mines, but have moved into communities, to see the importance of the empathy that coalfields communities have for each other. And I think that empathy is very much personified in the Coalfields Regeneration Trust, who I've had the pleasure to work with in the past when we were securing funds in Preston Pans in East Lothian. They came out as Preston Pans is a coalfields community, and initially at the first meeting someone said, but there are no pits in this town anymore, to which the Coalfields Regeneration Trust representatives rightly said, it's not actually about the mines, it's about the communities, it's about the people, it's about that that's been left, that Fulton MacGregor so accurately described, the challenge that the closure of those pits brought to our towns and our villages. And through working with the Coalfields Regeneration Trust, a significant number of community groups came forward with brilliant ideas how to improve life in and around Preston Pans, and indeed across East Lothian and our other mining communities that are there. But I want...
Rona Mackay.
the member for taking the intervention. Twecker and my constituency benefits greatly from the CRT Trust and has done over the years. Does the member agree with me that particularly for young people in communities, this is incredibly important?
Martin Whitfield.
Absolutely. I can't agree more than that, because the Coalfields Regeneration Trust don't send you an application form. They come out and talk to you. They come out and explain. They come out and find out what the challenges are that our young people, that our older people, that our community groups face. And they say, well, what would help? And it might be something as simple as it was in the case that I was involved in getting play equipment for a play park. It might just be a bench so that people can sit down and chat together. It might be specialised equipment for disabled children. It might be an accessible toilet for a working men's club that previously didn't have one but found itself excluding members. It might be, as in the case of Harlaw Day Centre in Preston Pans and the Penny Pit, recovering after COVID, coming back with those unexpected costs that allowed them to reopen and go back to being part of the beating heart of a community. And it is a great tribute to the CRT that they are able to talk to the communities in their way. I'm more than happy to.
Paul McLennan. Thank you, Mr. McLennan.
Yeah, can I thank the member for taking an intervention? Just to supplement what Mr. Whitfield is saying, I've had the pleasure of meeting the CRT as well in East Lothian. The real key thing, I think, for me is how they drive community spirit and community regeneration. And there's a few community councils, for example, Trinette, McMurray, Elphiston, that they've worked with. But it's working with local charities, the community-led generation, as I said, SusTrans, ELC, East Lothian Council itself, Recharge and East Lothian Food Bank are to mention just a few. So it's really just to supplement and complement the CRT on the role in East Lothian.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for that intervention. It's right, because the CRT approach our communities the same way as the coalfield communities used to help and assist each other. Sometimes it might have been a slap around the head if you were doing the wrong thing, but more often than not, it was a bowl of sugar or tea if you didn't have it. Time is short, and I do want to return to the three asks that have already been raised, but to concentrate specifically on task two, about an amendment to the procurement rules in order to allow the CRT to deliver grants programme to support grassroots communities. Because the grants that they provide are hundreds of pounds. They're not thousands, tens of thousands, although they have in the past done this. They are small grants that people who otherwise wouldn't be able to get access to them would not get. They would not go out and ask. They wouldn't know who to ask. But the CRT helped with that. And let me finish with just a stakeholder's view that I think actually encompasses all that sits in the asks tonight and all that sits within this debate. The CRT helps us to filter out the loudest people so that everyone gets heard. And I think that's a massive tribute to a charity that serves a community that deserve to be heard, that deserve to be listened to, and deserve to be supported. I'm grateful for your time, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. Can I say to our very welcome guests in the gallery that actually, under the parliamentary rules, we're not allowed members of the public in the gallery to participate in the proceedings, albeit I appreciate how strongly you feel about the issues being discussed. So thank you very much for your cooperation. I call Richard Leonard to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Mr. Leonard.
Can I thank Alec Rowley for initiating this vital debate, and can I extend my welcome to members of the Trust who are joining us tonight in the public gallery? Because Coalfield communities are still reeling from the consequences of what happened 40 years ago, when the miners waged a year-long struggle in a fight not just for jobs, not just for pits, but for communities and an entire way of life. Now, next year we will mark the 40th anniversary of that bitter dispute, but we will mark it not just by wistfully looking backwards, not just by looking back in anger, but by drawing on that fighting spirit, those values of community, those principles of solidarity, and applying them to the challenges that we are facing today. So what a blow it would be if, as we approach the 40th anniversary of that heroic and historic struggle, if we sit back and we allow the Scottish Government to withdraw its support from those very same communities who were hammered 40 years ago. communities that are still living with the consequences, because these are the facts. 43% of the population of the Scottish coalfields are claiming some form of benefit compared to a Scottish average of 23%. 40% of people in the Scottish coalfields have no qualifications, compared to 27% for Scotland as a whole. And the mortality rate in the Scottish coalfields is 25% higher than the Scottish average. Does the government think that this is because the people who live in these villages and in these towns are feckless, that they are unintelligent, that they are beyond education, or that even they have a disregard for life itself? Why are you turning your backs on them? Just yesterday, I visited Gorebridge Community Cares in Mid Lothian. It is supported by the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. It was started with a grant from the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. Run from a former police station, it's a CAB outreach centre, a food bank, a base for upwards mobility, supporting over 20 remarkable students who just need a helping hand. It's the home for elderly walking groups. It brings the generations together, puts on employability, training courses, backs business development, and provides lifeline support from the COVID Economic Recovery Fund. I spent some time with two of its outstanding workers, Lynn Roy and Vary Barrett. Vary Barrett told me this. She says, we support people from the nursery to 90. But she also had a clear message for this parliament. She said, no one understands mining villages, mining communities like the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. Next year, as well as marking the 40th anniversary of the miners' strike, we will mark the 25th anniversary of the death of the miners' leader, Mick McGaughey. He prophetically warned of the decimation of the Scottish coalfield if the Thatcher government had its way, because he understood better than anyone what it would do to mining communities. And he was right. His memorable appeal was, if we stop running, they'll stop chasing us. Stand firm and fight. And that is what we are doing tonight, fighting for these communities. Because I tell the Minister that you cannot be allied to a just transition and support unjust austerity. You cannot be an ally of the miners and support a policy which condemns their sons and daughters, their grandchildren, to a lifetime of poverty. You cannot be an ally to these communities and support these cuts. So the government needs to decide which side it is on. And I hope that it will be on the side of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust, on the side of the miners, of their families, of their trade union, and on the side of these villages and communities, because they deserve nothing less.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Colin Smith. Mr. Kerr.
Well, it's a pleasure to follow Richard Leonard, and to think that really it is 40 years coming up since that Titanic struggle that he referenced in his, as usual, impassioned and energetic remarks. And so it will be 40 years since Richard Leonard and I at Stirling University first crossed swords on issues relating to the government of our country at that time. And he has lost none of his passion, none of his conviction. And I admire that. I admire politicians who have principle and who have convictions and who have passion. But he's right in what he says when he highlights the fact that the work of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust, and by the way, thanks to Alex Rowley for bringing this motion to the chamber tonight, but he's right when he describes what is happening in those communities. And the most important word that this debate will feature is the word community. But when he talks about issues relating to welfare benefit claimants, when he talks about underqualification, underemployment, when he talks about mortality, these are issues that really should concern us. And so when the government, the Scottish government, the SNP, propose cutting the grant for the Coalfields Regeneration Trust, an organisation I admire close up and at a distance, both as a Member of Parliament for Stirling and now as a Central Scotland MSP, I think this is a huge mistake because of the nature of the engagement that the Coalfields Regeneration Trust have with the communities that they exist to serve and support. And if we are in the business of transformation policies, then it is at the local level that these policies make a real difference. We can talk till the cows come home about strategies, but the truth is it's the work that is done in those communities that makes the real difference. So I offer a suggestion to the government to restore the £100,000 that they're taking from this grant. They often tell us in this chamber that if we come with ideas about spending more money, then we should come up with a place from which that money can be taken. Well, I can give the chamber this advice, and I offer this advice to the minister. Why not, in the spirit of today's budget, why not, in the spirit of that budget, does the Scottish Government not cut itself by reducing the number of ministers in this government from a record high by one? And that would free up more than £100,000, which could then be directed towards the work, the excellent work, that the Coalfields Regeneration Trust do in Scotland. Now, with the little bit of time I have left, let me just add these comments, because community, as I said earlier, is the most powerful word, I think, that we will hear in this debate. And community is something that Scotland, especially our working class communities, were renowned for and should be renowned for now. And we need to support community. And that's exactly what the Coalfields Regeneration Trust do. Now, there's a group. I will, yes.
Briefly, Fils McGregor.
Thank the member for taking intervention. I'm glad that he is supporting the Coalfields Regeneration Trust, and I think the people in the gallery will be grateful for that as well. But does he not have any sense of hypocrisy that he is almost through his speech and has not talked about the UK government's role in the decimation of mining communities like mine over the years? And is he not even going to mention it, or is it just an irrelevance to him?
Stephen Kerr.
Of course it's not an irrelevance, but we're talking about the work of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. We can have a historic discussion, if you like. We can talk about that outside of the chamber. I'm more than happy to talk about the issues that prevailed 40 years ago, but we're not in an episode of Doctor Who, and we can't be transported back 40 years and revisit those issues and make any tangible difference to what has happened. But what we can do is highlight the fact that the government that the member supports has just cut £100,000 from a vitally important source of funding for the work of this trust, and that should be reversed. I can see that I'm probably out of time, so I'm just going to very quickly mention, with your permission, Deputy Presiding Officer, earlier this year, as an example of community, earlier this year the people of Reading commemorated the 100th anniversary of the Reading pit disaster. An inrush of water trapped 66 miners underground at a mine shaft, and there were 40 fatalities. 40 families who were impacted by one of the worst mining disasters in Scotland's history. Now, there are a group of very good people who have kept, as we've been referenced in relation to another pit disaster, and there are good people who have kept the commemoration going. Hundreds of people attend these commemorations every year. Family members of some of the victims have flown in from all over the world to be in attendance to register their solidarity with the local community. And it's in the wellspring of that history that community lives on in these former mining and ex-coalfield communities. And I salute the work of the Trust and hope that the government will have a moment of conscience on this day of budget and consider seriously my suggestion that one of them gives up their post so that money can be used for a better local engagement funding project.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Karen Walken. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Alex Rowley for his hugely important and also timely motion. As we head towards the 25th anniversary of the establishment of the Coalfield Regeneration Trust, it's an opportune time not only to reflect on the work of the Trust, but to recognise that this work has never been more important. I'm proud to represent South Scotland, communities steeped in Scotland's mining history, where coal seams literally run the length of the region from Midlothian, the east, once home to 26 collieries, and today, of course, the National Mining Museum, neighbouring East Lothian, home to the earliest coal mines in Scotland between Trinent and Preston Pan, and where the local Labour Club ensured that children were still fed a hot meal after school every day during that miners' strike. South Lanarkshire, with some of the most valuable coal seams, paved the way to making it the seat of the iron smelting industry. And on the West Coast, Ayrshire, where at one time 14,000 coal miners mined 4 million tonnes of coal a year, and where a certain Keir Hardie founded the Ayrshire Miners' Union, leading to the National Union of Scottish Mine Workers. Now, even in Dumfriesshire, where I live, an area many may not associate with coal mines, deep mining was integral to the economy as far south as Canonbay and Rowanburn, and more recently in Upper Nithsdale from the Faldhead Mine in Kirkconnell, the largest local pit until it closed in 1968, to the open cast that continued until just a few years ago. Well, many of my relatives worked in those Upper Nithsdale pits until the demise of the industry in the 1980s, forcing them to move, in some cases, to the northeast to find work in the oil industry. And we often hear ministers in this chamber rightly say that if there's one lesson we must take from the demise of the pits and the devastation that inflicted on our communities, it's the need to learn the lessons of the past and make sure we have a just transition for our oil and gas sector. They rightly point out, never again can we have a government inflict such economic vandalism on communities and then walk away, meaning many of those coalfield communities have still not recovered. But, Presiding Officer, ministers can't make those statements on the one hand and then on the other hand cut the funding of the organisation solely dedicated to supporting those very communities. This cut to the Coalfield Regeneration Trust isn't just £100,000. It's also been a freeze in funding since 2011. That's an additional real terms cut of over £250,000. And as we've heard, the Trust won't be able to run their grants programme to support smaller grassroots charities in those communities as a result of the government's procurement rules. When I wrote to the Minister in the summer about those cuts, he dismissed them. He claimed there are plenty of other sources of funding. But as the Trust survey of the organisations affected showed, that's not their experience. And the government's approach fails to recognise the need for additional support for those communities over and above those other sources of funding. The Trust grants programme, even the smallest sums of money, make a big difference to those communities. Now, there isn't time to list the successes, but take one programme in my community, the Community Action Plan in Kirkconnell and Kellahome in Upper Nithsdale, where a small investment by the Trust supported the plan's development and early delivery of some of the projects. But the Trust also brought their expertise to the table, that understanding of the needs of coalfield communities, helping ensuring the plan's priorities were the community's priorities, and their support also levered in other sources of funding. So, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I'd appeal to the Minister, as others have done this evening, including members of his own group, rethink those cuts, which are an attack on our coalfield communities. Rethink your procurement rules to allow the Trust to continue that important grant programme to support those grassroots community organisations, and then work with the Trust to invest in and create that new model to provide a sustainable income stream needed to invest in our coalfield communities, because that would end the need for grants in the long term, but it's about investing in the Trust in the short term. Because if this government is genuinely committed to a just transition, its actions, not warm words, need to recognise that hasn't happened in our coalfield communities. And now, Minister, it's not the time to walk away from those communities. It's time to support them.
Thank you, Mr Smith. And I call Carol Mochen. Ms Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank my colleague Alec Rowley for bringing this really important issue to the attention of the Parliament at this time. Can I start by saying how proud I am to say that I grew up, live and now represent a coalfield community. And I want to thank the visitors in the gallery who, like me, believe in these communities, not only because of our history of mining and powering the country, but because our history built a resilient people, bold communities with warmth, talent and tenacity. They deserve the wealth generated from the labour of our parents, our grandparents and the wider communities. It is almost 40 years since the rapid closure of the mining industries began, and former coalfield communities within my own South of Scotland region are still feeling the consequences. We've heard about the inequality in work opportunities and the need to claim benefits. We've heard about the inequalities in educational opportunities. and about the mortality rates. And I am going to read that again. The mortality rate in the Scottish coalfields is 25% higher than the Scottish average. Make no mistake, that is by economic design. And we in this place, us here, we have to take responsibility to change the direction of this. And that is what this debate is this evening. The Coalfields Regeneration Trust do such important work in my own region, and we've heard from other members across. I live in Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley, and they are a central part of our community and function as a model of how to effectively build progress in conjunction with communities rather than imposing things on those communities. And we have heard that this Parliament recognises that. In Alec Rowley's speech this evening, we talked about the benefits, recognised 112 motions in this Parliament recognising the benefits. When mining went, or rather when mining was taken away so cruelly, many of our Ayrshire mining communities were simply left to struggle. As anyone in Ayrshire knows, mining was a core part of our very identity, and it remains so until this day. That isn't simply forgotten by an economic change. Without mining, many of these towns and villages would simply never have come to be. And that leaves a lasting cultural memory for many people that still live there. It was the centre of their work or the work of their parents. And as such, they see themselves first and foremost as mining communities. Now, let's be clear. Those communities didn't create that, rather those communities fell victim to the kinds of social and economic problems that we all know in our similar areas across the coalfields. Unemployment, lack of investment by government and an accepted decline of services. And these are scars that take a long time to heal. And the effects they have on the day-to-day lives of local people, families over generations, is still very clear to see. Organisations like the Coalfield Regeneration Trust stepped into that gap, that void, and as there was rapid and unthinking deindustrialisation, they have pioneered projects right across. We've heard from them, Yip World, The Zone, Auckland Lake Community Development Initiative, Epic Pipe Band, Nether Third Initiative for Community Empowerment. These are the kinds of projects that we need in our communities. Without their help, we simply would be in a worse state. If you live there, you know that no one needs to say it. No one needs to say it. We see it every day. The Coalfields Regeneration Trust is essential to our communities. I want to just go over again the points that have been made. We need the government to support a capital endowment for Community Regeneration Trust. We need the Scottish Government to change its procurement rules. And we need to restore the funding for the Coalfields Regeneration Trust. We know that we need to do those things. And in the words of Mick McGahey, let's stand firm and fight. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mockin. And I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick, Minister, to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I congratulate Alex Rowley on securing this important day and thank members for their contributions from across the Chamber. I want to start by reaffirming our commitment to supporting our coalfield communities, which is demonstrated by our long-standing support for the Coalfields Regeneration Trust and through the range of investments we deliver to support coalfield and all disadvantaged communities across Scotland. I want to just highlight Martin Whitfield's, I think, quote of the day, of the debate, when he reminded us that the Coalfield Regeneration Trust is not about the mines, it's about the people, it's about the communities. And I think that's a really important thing for us to remember. So the Scottish Government has provided over £28 million to the Trust since it was established in 1999. This reflects the valuable role they've played in supporting our coalfield communities, building capacity of coalfield communities and delivering essential support through the range of Trust activities. It probably is worth taking a moment to touch on the points raised by Fulton MacGregor, Mr. Smith and a few others around what happened 40 years ago, because there is a relevance as we're coming up to that anniversary in that while this Parliament has taken action, The UK Government have still not apologised for what happened back then, and there is still a requirement for a full UK-wide public inquiry into what happened back then. That said, in the last number of years since 1999, there have been many challenges faced in our coalfield communities and in other disadvantaged communities where market failure and rurality has had an enduring impact on social, physical and economic outcomes. Our long-term support for the Trust is mirrored in our approach to regeneration, recognising that change takes place over time. We have a strong policy framework in place to realise our long, medium and short-term ambitions to improve the lives of people across Scotland. And we are seeing the impact and successes of our approach through targeting our investment to those communities that need support the most. But I must be clear that the financial climate we operate in is the most challenging it has ever been. As a result, we must look at every penny and ensure that it has been spent on those things that have the greatest impact. So we have worked closely.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for the member to give way. And on that point, I mean, I'm not abandoning the other claims, but an alteration in the Scottish procurement rules would allow the CRT to continue to hand out grants, even small grants, which we've heard across this chamber tonight are so beneficial and fundamental to giving a dignity back to these communities.
Minister.
Yeah, and I will come to that very specific point. But we have worked closely with the Trust this year and we've been open about the financial position faced, working with a reduced budget to deliver our Empowering Communities programme, which supports CRT's grant. That programme also delivers essential support direct to community organisations, delivering frontline activities and services to tackle local challenges of poverty and disadvantage for our communities most in need across Scotland, including coalfield areas. So we're not ignoring coalfield communities, as Mr Stewart implied, and nor are we turning our backs, as Mr Leonard suggested in his contribution. In fact, our support goes wider than directly funding to CRT. And I want to highlight, further to Mr Smith's point, I want to highlight two opportunities for further funding. So our Strengthening Communities programme and Investing in Communities funds are two funds which are able to be applied for across Scotland and which have and are directly supporting coalfield communities. So the Investing in Communities fund is delivering over £1.7 million investment in 2023-24 in coalfield communities, such as the project in Methil Hill, providing accessible preschool childcare, after-school clubs, youth clubs and volunteering opportunities for over 70 young people to gain employability, skills and training. And the Strengthening in Communities programme is currently providing a total of £600,000 supporting the development of community anchor organisation in coalfield communities. I'm going to finish with a number of points, including his own, which I will try and pick up. In organisation in coalfield communities, for example, the support is helping Bothwell Futures, who are in the process of asset transfer of the Bothwell Library, which will be an important space for the community.
Stephen Kerr.
The Minister is engaging in a little bit of whataboutery here, because the purpose of this debate is to consider the CRT and the work they do. And everyone has agreed, everyone that's spoken has agreed that what they do is highly impactful. So can I ask the Minister then, £100,000, very small in the total scheme of the many multiple billions that the Scottish Government has at disposal, will he... Yes, I know that...
Mr Kerr, please just ask your question.
Yeah, so my question is, would the Minister seriously consider my serious suggestion that the Government cut its cost by £100,000 and divert that money to the CRT?
Minister.
Thanks, Mr Kerr. And obviously, given the challenges of the budget that we've just passed today, all public services are having to look at how we hold our money together. But the point I was reflecting and the reason I was in... highlighting the Investing in Communities Fund and the Strengthening Communities Programme is because of a point that Mr Smith raised. However, reflecting the contribution that CRT makes, we have, in spite of the challenging fiscal position, provided a substantial grant of nearly £650,000, enabling the Trust to continue the delivery of their employability programmes, skills and training programmes and capacity building programmes, which the Government does recognise. So I was pleased to meet with trustees in September to listen to their concerns, which provided me with the opportunity to convey our ongoing support and commitment to work with them. It also gave me the opportunity to stress the importance of ensuring their continued to support the delivery of our regeneration outcomes. Mr Whitfield, Fulton MacGregor, Alex Rowley and a few others all made reference in their contributions to the Coalfield Investment Programme, the small grants funds, and I do absolutely understand and appreciate the points made about access to small grant funding. Our procurement rules and grant making conditions exist to support proper use of public funds. However, I have asked my officials to explore with CRT about where possible and appropriate to identify other ways in which this trust can support small community grant organisations. But I must be clear that the overall grant allocation for 2023-2024 cannot be increased. In terms of future funding for CRT, you'll be acutely aware of the ongoing budget challenges over the medium terms. The FM has been clear that every penny must be able to be demonstrated how it supports the three central missions of equality, opportunity and community, and our budget will deliver against these missions. The Deputy First Minister, I'm going to be mindful of our time, in her statement to Parliament today, set out the spending plans for 2024-25 and announcing the draft budget, which will be scrutinised by members of this Parliament over the coming weeks. It reflects the very difficult choices that have to be made as a result of the autumn statement and the impacts that UK government decisions have on Scotland. I'm mindful of our time. Presiding Officer, I want to go straight to the conclusion, and the point being that conclusion, I want to reaffirm our commitment to supporting the work that delivers impact against our core missions and to continue to support the Coalfield Regenerations Trust as much as we can within our limited resources, and the valuable contribution that they make, helping our Coalfield communities to thrive to the best of our ability within the constraints of this financial position that we find ourselves in. I thank the Coalfield Regeneration Trust for coming along today and listening to the important debate. I hope they will have felt the support for them across the chamber, and I will continue to do what I can to support them in being a sustainable organisation to support our Coalfield communities across Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.